Human Resource Management on BCTV is supported by Mosteller and Associates.
Hi, I'm Christy. I'm a local business owner and bilingual HR professional. SHRM has been a great resource for me. The meetings are always very informative, and there's always hot coffee, breakfast, and HR credits. SHRM's a way for local HR professionals and national members to stay on top of laws and regulations while also getting to connect with other business owners and HR professionals. Through SHRM, I actually obtained my HR certifications, and I've been able to get more involved at the committee level, which has allowed me to greater impact our local community. Even more importantly, I've been able to bring back important information into our business to help reduce our risks and improve our overall business in order to grow and evolve in today's market. Hi, my name is Amy.
Good evening. My name is Bob Orzechowski. I'm Chief Operating Officer for a medical practice and welcoming you tonight to a live showing Tuesday, May 11th at 6 p.m. to 7 p.m. We have a live program on human resource management, our regular bi-monthly program. It's our 97th show into our 16th year, hard to believe. And I'd like to introduce our panel tonight. We have to my left, Denise Lee, Director of Training and Development. And welcome back, Denise. Thank you for coming here again.
Yeah, thank you, Bob.
And we have, because of the COVID policies, there's two of us in the studio, but we also have two members of our diversity and inclusion.
Tough. Shall I help you out, Bob?
It's tough to articulate when you buy your teeth through the mail, you know. But we have them as home viewers tonight on the Zoom session. Julie Franey is the HR lead for a local manufacturing company and is SHRM certified. And Michael Holcomb, an HR consultant, also SHRM certified. And they are with us and will be participating throughout the program. We just can't accommodate them here in the studio. We want to thank our underwriter, Mosteller & Associates. It's a full-service professional consulting firm assisting organizations of all sizes, I think it's up and down the Eastern Seaboard now. The information is on your screen. We thank them for their support, and you can see they're located, they're headquartered at 2433 Morgantown Road, Suite 100, and their contact information's there. Give Chet a call, and you can tell him that you heard about him here on the program. He'd appreciate that, too. The program tonight, speaking of that, is Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Issues for HR and Employment in Our Local Labor Market. We wanted to add that piece to it. One of the many committees we have in the local SHRM chapter is a very active and dynamic diversity and inclusion committee, of which Denise here in studio tonight is chair. A little bit of a disclaimer, nothing here is meant to be legal advice, and the opinions of the panelists are our own and not necessarily those of our employers nor of BCTV. Speaking of BCTV, we have to give them a shameless plug, their mission to enhance the unity and strength of our community and providing this medium for dialogue, serving as an information source, and most importantly, a forum for idea exchange. This program particularly is online streamed, bctv.org, and on YouTube, so we're international. And the replays Friday at 8 p.m., Saturday at 1 p.m., and Wednesday at 9 a.m. So no matter where you are in the world and what shift you're working or what time it is, you can catch these programs, folks. A little bit about the Society for Human Resource Management. It's an international organization. And it's probably in, I don't know, 100 countries and has several hundred thousand members. Of course, the United States is their headquarters down in Alexandria, Virginia. And the Berks County Chapter 179, which you can see there how to reach us if you're interested in checking out the website, if nothing else, and what we do. We are an affiliated chapter, which means we follow all their rules and regulations as best we can. We have our own goals, missions, and benefits of membership. And I'm going to ask, invite Mike, Michael, and Julie to share a little bit about our local chapter, why they belong, what they get out of it, even in this last year of being COVID isolated.
Sure. Hi. Good evening, Bob and Denise and Michael. This is Julie Franey, and I will start if you don't mind. But I think this past year, even with our COVID situation, we received as a chapter, as chapter members, such incredibly, incredibly important information that we can still utilize for our workplaces and for our positions. So even though we did a lot of all of our meetings online and through Zoom and through phone calls, we still got all the important information that we can utilize in our workplace. And we still had the connection with all of the members.
Mm-hmm. Michael?
Tagging on to what Julie mentioned, first of all, my name is Michael Holcomb, and I belong to the SHRM organization because of the information and the networking that is so integral. And like Julie said, even though all of our meetings were online, it was still great to see the other HR professionals and hear from them and the experiences that they were having in dealing with COVID, which, as it was commonly described, a novel virus. So it was a novel experience for all of us. There was lots of new and unprecedented experiences and situations that many of us countered, not only in the workplace, but perhaps also in organizations that we belong to. And our professional expertise, our professional guidance was called into play to help take our organizations and our employers or our places of employment through through the COVID experience.
Mm-hmm. We also took our technical knowledge to a new level.
Yes, we did.
Absolutely.
We're known for that, but yes, we did. I'm still trying to figure out Zoom and opening up screens for people and things, but we're making do there. The local chapter also supports the certification efforts, the professional certification efforts of our members. We provide professional development credits for those who are already certified. And it's a real challenge this year, but we're rather successful with that as well. We are involved in the community with the Olivet's Boys and Girls Club Police Athletic League event that I think was very successful this year over the post-holiday season. And speaking of tonight's topic, and I'll turn it over to Denise here. This is her area of certainly deeper study than mine, admittedly. But the Society for Human Resource Management, of course, is heavily focused on this DEI initiative with a Together Forward program, which I would encourage you to get onto shrm.org, and I'm sure you'll find all the information you need there. So without any further ado, I'll turn it over right now to Denise. And once a year, we try to have the DE&I program. And it's basically good HR. But it's becoming more challenging, I think, with the kind of labor force we're faced with. We've lost certain populations, and we have to talk about effective recruiting strategies. There's just so much to deal with, but I think you have a slide to start us out.
I do. What I wanted to share with you is that, you know, right now it is so critical that we really get our arms around DEI, diversity, equity, and inclusion. Because if we take a look around, the demographics are changing, our communities are changing, and as a result, our workplaces are changing. You know, as you can see on this slide that's there, you know, you can see people of color are going to comprise more than 50% of the U.S. population. We have five generations in the workplace. You know, so if you take a look at everything that's on that slide, you know that, you know, we have to be prepared. We really have to take a look at, you know, how are we addressing this in our workplaces? You know, I've been working with diversity initiatives for over 20-some years. And I remember when we first got started, we would talk a lot about diversity and talking about what was different. And then we kind of moved into diversity and we were talking about, okay, what's the same about all of us? Then we introduced inclusion. And then the inclusion was the piece that was going to tie it all together, because we were bringing diverse people into the organization, but organizations weren't being successful because they weren't setting the stage and making sure that the environment was right.
Excuse me, you had the greatest definition I heard about diversity and inclusion and the dance or whatever.
Yes, exact words.
I love that.
Well, I mean, and it's, you know, it's not mine. I wish it was mine, but I had read somewhere before where someone had made the statement that diversity is like going to the dance. Inclusion is being invited to actually dance. But the one that I really like is that diversity is like the Energized Bunny. Inclusion is the Energized Buddy with the battery.
Yes, you're absolutely right.
Okay.
There's just so much to this topic, and even though in the more modern workplace and in the general population, they might have different views of it, but as human resource professionals, it's again just good HR to try to have the best talent. And in the COVID era, that hasn't been made any easier.
Mm-hmm.
When was the last time prior to COVID you saw help wanted ads on billboards?
Mm-hmm.
Didn't happen. I'd like to get ask Julie and then Michael if they could comment on the challenges they've faced, not only in their professional roles as HR people, but also with the DE&I issues that they're experiencing in their particular environments. And then we'll get back to Denise with why the employers really need to be concerned with this. Julie?
Well, if I may begin, we did have some issues with recruiting, especially CDLA drivers. And what we're finding, we used to, it would be very helpful to have employee referrals, but then we realized those referrals, you're getting the same type of person, the same demographics, the same way of thinking, the same way. And then I thought about past practices and past employers. And I thought in my last position, I had our entire executive committee included all white older men. So after a while, that's how you start to think, and you don't include other ideas and other people and other ways of thinking and doing. And I think that's the real challenge right now. You know, how do we get out of our own way? And now that COVID's a little bit more reasonable, we are having an easier time recruiting at all levels.
And are there any parts of your secret sauce that you can share with us, or is that going to make your recruiting job even tougher because other people know it?
No. I think what I try to do is be as unbiased as possible in the job posting, so I can recruit anyone. So anyone reads it, and as long as they feel they can meet the essential functions of the position, they will apply.
And Julie, it's also important that, you know, not just the ad itself, but organizations mm-hmm. need to take a look at their websites. How welcoming
yes.
are their websites? You know, mm-hmm. because very often, if you have someone of a diverse background, the first place they're going is to your website. And if they mm-hmm. don't see people that look like them, they don't see the right language being used, they're not even going to consider that ad.
Yes, that is correct. And your interview questions are very important as well, because you don't want to show any any bias in those questions to disclude anyone or make someone feel that they do not belong there in that environment.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, thank you very much. And Michael, it seems like, and I know many people admit in HR, admit to simply not having sophisticated the language of DE&I and weaving that into their professional thinking and even their personal thinking. But can you share anything about what your own experiences? You've been around a bit and certified and all that. So how's COVID been with HR and DE&I in your world?
So as far as the impact of COVID, I think like Julie said, as things are waning, I'm not really seeing COVID so much an impact from a recruitment standpoint other than possibly affecting the numbers. But I was going, one of the things I wanted to make mention is coming from a large corporation background that placed a huge focus on good faith efforts and really promoting diversity or equity and inclusion, really hiring the right person for the right position. Are they going to be a fit to, are they the right person for the job that they're going to be successful in that role? Can they do the role? Can they handle the role? What are they going to bring to the table as far as the culture of the organization? And how do you accomplish that? I think it's important to advertise your jobs across as many different channels as possible, especially in some of our industries where they're either high turnover or the jobs get filled quickly. And that there's more jobs possibly than there are bodies or candidates to fill the jobs. So aggressive recruitment and targeting candidates across as many different channels as possible, not losing sight of some of your more traditional recruitment efforts, such as the website, print recruitment in like the newspaper or the merchandiser, but also means such as text to hire or apps and things like that, especially knowing your audience and what the what tools are going to target what particular demographic you're looking to hire.
Okay, and I know I'm going to come back to both of you a little bit further down the agenda with HR. Of course, is one of the competencies we have is compliance. And we're going to ask you a few noodle on that for a bit, too. But I want to turn it back to Denise here for a bit. And with diversity, it's bringing up age, religion, race, ethnicity. It can go on and on and on. And there was a great presentation recently. We got Sherm credits for it, but it was on the State Council legal and legislative agenda last Friday, and there was a lady talking about gender inclusion terminology, and I wouldn't have thought you could spend an hour talking about that narrative. Mm-hmm. And it got incredibly specific, touched on things that we just don't normally think about, and for HR to learn almost a whole new language in a lot of ways. Could you speak to that a little bit?
You know, one of the things that's really critical about the whole DEI is making sure that we are using inclusive language. So I'm sure that part of that discussion, Bob, was around some of the different terminology. And we as HR individuals, we need to make sure that we understand what language we should be using, because that language can be offensive, or, you know, we can exclude people. You know, for instance, when we talk about, you know, someone that's maybe, let's say, an individual that's blind, you know, instead of saying a blind person, we say a woman who is blind. So you put the individual first, and that's how that inclusive language piece works. And there's certain terminology that we have to make sure that we're using. So we have to educate ourselves. We have to make sure that we're not unintentionally hurting someone or putting someone down. And, you know, one of the things that I do is I talk a lot about some of the different terminology that we've used over the years, you know, like the peanut gallery. And, you know, when I mention that in training and I say, well, you know, ask people, why do you think we shouldn't use peanut gallery? And people just use it. They don't know the history. However, if they understood the history behind some of these terminologies, they wouldn't use it. So when you talk about a peanut gallery, in a sense, you're putting African Americans down because years ago, when they would go to a show, they were placed either in the nosebleed or they were placed in the back, and they would be ridiculed because people would say, oh, you know, they're trying to act intelligent, you know, and they would call them, you know, back there in the peanut gallery. So again, a lot of times it's just a matter of educating ourselves around these different terms because they do, they can be harmful.
Well, even something as simple as male and female, I know in the building trades or just even around your house, you're talking to an electrician or something, you're talking about the male and female ends of the ends of the cord. Why not plug and socket? You know, so it's... And that's to your point. We were talking earlier before the show how we are who we were when, where we grew up, when we grew up, how we were spoken to as children, if you were raised in a heavily religious, Catholic or whatever environment, that that stays with you, and it's a cultural brand, a stamp almost. And the thing is, if HR doesn't have the lead in this and take the responsibility for DE&I, who will?
Right. You know, Bob, when you talk about terminology, just think of master-slave. That's used in the technical, right? And sometimes you have, even in HR, we are really guilty of using the grandfather clause. You know, so again, we have to really...
Those lawyers do that. They make us do that.
The lawyers...
Yeah, and it's true. It's there's just so much that we have to be, and then we come up with the LGBTQ plus sign, and with everything that HR has to be concerned with, I think it's a wake up call to get and be even better, and. We, you know, we participate to the extent we can. I know that SHRM organization has articles in its professional journal every month or every other month. I think it's produced. And last fall, it was almost exclusively devoted to diversity and various issues there in that area, but. Still, though, HR is responsible for compliance with a multitude of local ordinances, state and federal laws. So how do we make the shift from compliance and the discrimination issue that we face with every day and inclusion? And I'd ask Julie and Mike if they can noodle on that a bit, because we'll come back to it. Denise, there are some legal issues here. I know we're not attorneys. How important is the concept to HR people of protected class? Does it still have the demand on us that distracts us from the DE&I initiatives that we have to have?
I think it does, Bob. We still have to be very concerned as to some, you know, gender. How do we treat people, you know, how do we treat men? How do we treat women? You know, sexual orientation. A lot of those things are, you know, that are protected. There's still that need to make sure that they're protected and that we don't revert back to some of the practices that were in place before. But, you know, what I encourage organizations to do is really begin to care about people. If they started to treat individuals fairly, if they started to treat people equitable, you know, and they realize that every individual has value, then some of that stuff goes away because you're not treating people different. If you understand that everyone that you invite to the table, first of all, we got to invite them to the table, but everyone that's invited to the table, you know, they have ideas, they have viewpoints, and utilizing those viewpoints, utilizing their perspective is helping you to work through different problems. Whereas before, you had the same type of individual addressing problems, and you were coming up with the same kind of solutions. When you open up that table and you're inviting a very diverse group, you have an opportunity to address that problem differently.
And one of the things that it's a difference that HR people have to be aware of, the concept of disparate treatment versus disparate impact. We're always developing policies. We're revising policies. How many of us revised our travel and quarantine policies for our staffs over a 5 or 6 month period in 2020, you know, a dozen times, mm-hmm. as the science kept changing and the regulations kept changing. But we've also got to be aware of that with these policies, that disparate treatment is such that we design it specifically to discriminate and have adverse impact. Mm-hmm. Disparate impact, your policies can still be written with the best of intentions, but HR still has to have a way to monitor that. And I see we're getting ready for a very brief intermission here halfway through the program. Julie and Mike, we're going to come back to you both with your take on the pull push between the inclusion concept and being concerned about discrimination concepts as well. And it's almost like having a foot in each canoe. We'll be right back, and then we'll go from there.
Hi, my name is Amy Malecki. I am the market leader for Manpower in the southeastern Pennsylvania market. I joined SHRM about 2 years ago. I had just recently moved to the area. I needed to make community connections. I wanted to meet new people. So I thought SHRM would be a great opportunity. It has been. The benefits and advantages that I've received from my membership have just been meeting, you know, tons of people, communicating with them, coming to the meetings, always full of energy, great information that we can take back as HR professionals and I can use every day while I'm supporting workforce development and retention at Manpower. So that to me is what SHRM is all about, just that community engagement, giving people the opportunity to build positive relationships, collaborate, develop strategic partnerships to enhance their career and development. Hi.
We're back live again. We are live tonight, as I said, Tuesday, May 11th. And the telephone number for home viewers, 610-378-0426. We are talking about diversity, equity, and inclusion issues for HR and the local employment market. And we're going to turn it back to Julie and Mike here. Michael for a moment, and ask them to address any of the other issues they see. We're trying to avoid in some way the technical aspects of all of this, affirmative action plans and all those things that HR has to wrestle with. But there still are very real issues out there, and I'd ask Julie and Michael here to think about issues they've seen. Do they have any success stories? Do they have any stories that maybe weren't so successful around these initiatives? I think most companies get it. They want to do well, but maybe they don't know the secret sauce of making it happen. And it's not the why questions, it's the how questions that sometimes can be mm-hmm. more vexing. And Julie and Michael, I think we'd ask you to comment on that if you could, please.
Sure. I'm hyper aware of conversations and awareness and education. So if I overhear something that's said that's inappropriate or someone tells me about that and I investigate it, I am all about coaching and explaining to people, putting people in other people's shoes and explaining why that was not appropriate for whatever reason. And also, I try and do that from a place too, where I firmly believe that everyone is good at something. So if you can drill down with all of your employees from the top down, what are they very good at? And then encourage them to utilize that skill or that expertise or the experience in their positions and in their roles, and to come forward if they're comfortable with that, or maybe do it in writing if they're not. Not everyone's comfortable with public speaking. Then it sort of breaks down the barriers and people become more comfortable working with each other, understanding each other. The other day, it was, I think one of the examples is one of our employees was celebrating and observing a Jewish holiday. And I overheard another employee asking them about it, and they were very respectful. They truly wanted to understand. And I thought, wow, that is great. And I later pulled that gentleman aside and I said, I'm so happy you did that, because now you know something that you did not know before. And you understand something about that person that you didn't understand before. So I really try to catch people doing good things and then compliment them on it, and then also coach people rather than disciplining them when they do something that is inappropriate or that could be discriminatory in nature.
Excellent. Excellent. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Julie. Michael, how about
you?
So I will add to that. My experience comes from working for a large national, or I guess you could say international, retailer that has a presence in all 50 states, and as well as Canada and Mexico. And I think, well, I would say fortunately or unfortunately, I had the experience of working in several different divisions, regions across the country during my time with this company. And I think education and training, as well as modeling positive behaviors, is absolutely key. We had our CHRO, who was really instrumental in driving the DEI initiative for the company and really bringing that to the table. And the organization was structured as such that because she had a seat at the table at the corporate level, those of us who were in HR in the stores or district or regional level, we also had seats at the table and had the ability to implement or cascade trainings, as well as model the behaviors that the organization was looking for. But as I think you mentioned earlier, Bob, it really starts at the top of an organization and rolling that out or cascading that out to your various mid-level managers, entry-level managers. And my personal experience, I was able to make a comparison from Pennsylvania and New Jersey here in the Northeast to some time spent in Dallas, Texas, and it was definitely an interesting experience to see that difference, not necessarily very positive, but I think, like I said, being empowered to cascade behaviors, I was able to take my knowledge and experience from the time I spent with this company here in the Northeast and take that to Texas and become involved in various DEI initiatives. And like I said, this particular organization recognized that having that that DEI focus, I guess you will, or focus if you will, among employees translated to better customer service and better sales when it came to sales and profits.
Thank you very much. And we will come back to both of you a little bit later on with some topics you can think about in the meantime. You've made your notes already from the agenda on item number 6 there with unconscious bias, microaggression, gender equality, and especially how we weave it into what Julie was saying, help wanted ads, recruiting efforts, and especially the all-important position descriptions and that sort of thing. But I want to turn it back to Denise here, and we had another slide we wanted to get up.
Okay. Yes, I would ask the home viewers to really take a look at this slide, you know, and see, you know, if you look at that graphic on equality and you look at the graphic on equity, you know, take a look at it and see exactly what's there, what's happening there. And I'm going to pause just for a moment, Bob.
Yep, it's a great one. It's picture's worth a thousand words, and this mm-hmm. is a classic example of it.
It really is, and I came across this, and I just thought it was absolutely wonderful. But if you look at it, and if you look at the equality one, most organizations really focused on equality. They said, you know, I'm going to treat everybody the same. Everybody's going to get the same advantages. Everyone's going to get the same opportunities. But take a look at that. If you look at those three individuals, they're all trying to see that game. However, look at the first one. Does he have full view? Look at the second one, part view. And look at the third. Where's the view there? But also take a look at the playing field. Is that a level playing field? I'm sure you would say no. So then if you move over to equity, you can see where everyone now has a good view of the game. However, look what happened there. It's not a matter of just trying to level that playing field, but you're giving individuals what they need to be successful. So if you look, the first person, you know, really nothing was needed there. But if you look at the second one, they needed to put an extra box under that individual to make sure that they had full sight of the game. And the third, they needed to put a third box under that individual to make sure that they had full view. However, you know, when I have conversations with organizations around this, they say, well, you know, I'm not sure I'm into equity, but you have to move to equity because you have to make sure that you are somehow giving people what they need to be successful. And that's what's key in this slide.
Yeah, and it does drive home an important point. Mm-hmm. You know, one thing I've been in management for many years, taught the concepts, and I think I don't know what it is like in other countries, admittedly, but I think the important part of providing a little taller of a stool for the shorter person in the example, if we're looking at equity, we're talking about what's fair, what's just, what's impartial. But in order to make an effective DE&I program in your company, one of the things I think we do not a good job of in American management, overall management, and we have to lay that at the feet of HR in a lot of ways, is job design. I think we design work to fit labor markets, and we don't design work to fit the people we have. And we look for that ideal candidate that can do 99% of the job that we have to offer, and then do you want the job, take it or not, as opposed to maybe redesigning jobs on an iterative basis so that we can optimize everyone's strengths in the company. And that's a hard thing to do on a day-to-day basis. I know that, but I think if we can get better at job design, and of course now we're frustrated with so many people working from home, and that having, I think, a way more significantly negative impact on the female workforce, and especially with schooling. And I just can't imagine. I mean, unfortunately, our children are older, so we weren't faced with that. But I couldn't imagine, I still can't, companies dealing with that. And then you have also the cybersecurity issues on top of that. And we've had to grow up with redesigning jobs. I was wondering if you could, it's dawning on me here, is equity then the absence of bias? Mm-hmm. And is there a gradient scale on there, or if there's no bias, then there has to be equity? And if there is no equity, we have to find the bias and root it out? I mean, how does that work?
Well, I really think it takes individuals, they have to first come, and this is all HR people, HR professionals as well as leaders of organizations, they have to come in contact with their own unconscious bias. And, you know, and that takes work because a lot of us feel, hey, I have no biases. You know, I work very hard at making sure I don't have any biases. And one of the things that I introduce people to is an unbiased assessment where they can go out online and take this assessment. And then I get comments from people, wow, I can't believe I have that bias.
Can you share that lead with us, that we have that reference to that?
Let me see if I have it, but
We have time.
I'll take a look for it because I should have it here. But, you know, the one thing that's important, Bob, is that all of us have to come in contact with our own unconscious bias, and it takes some work. And we have to be open to accepting that it's there. You know, we have to think about our backgrounds. You know, it has a lot to do with how we were raised, the communities that we grew up in, the schools that we attended, the churches that we went to. You know, the media, of course, has a lot to do with it. So all this stuff has a major, major impact on us, and it had an impact on us when we were very young. So those things are kind of deep down in us, and they come out when we're stressed, or they come out when we are feeling challenged. And that's what we have to watch in the workplace, because how often are we really busy and we're kind of moving along and trying to get things done, and then someone comes up to us and we say something that's inappropriate? It's that bias coming out, and we don't know that it's there. You know, so it's one of those things that we have to really dig deep and find out what those biases are, because once we are aware of them, then it's less likely that it will come out. You know, then of course you know we talk about the unconscious, but we also have those explicit biases where we know we have those biases, and we tend to kind of hold them in because society will not allow us to demonstrate some of those biases. But again, those biases come out at various times when we feel frightened or threatened or something. You
know? And it can be that way. You know, HR is, there's something new in your job every day, mm-hmm. and you can't control it because you're the go-to person for so many of these issues. And another topic that's out there that people, I think, might not be aware of, and maybe it follows with unconscious bias, can you talk a little bit about microaggression? Mm-hmm. I mean, I know what aggression is. I know, being a former active duty Marine, we know all about aggression. In fact, you are rewarded for it. Mm-hmm. But microaggression in the employment context, in the DEI context, what is it?
Microaggressions are those kinds of behaviors that we do, and we're not really in touch with what the impact that behavior might have on someone else. For instance, one of the things I share when I do training around this is a video where, you know, two young ladies are sitting there talking, and the one person was talking to an African-American woman about her hair, and she wanted to know, well, you know, how do you... that natural hair, what do you do with it? And the person automatically reached out to touch the hair of this African-American person. And the person was insulted by that and kind of backed off. But you have to realize that those are the kind of things that have been happening all someone's life.
Violating the personal space.
Violating the personal space. But the other side of that, Bob, is that, you know, history shows that people have wanted to touch natural hair. And it is offensive. You know, do people walk up and just touch your hair? No, but will they walk up and touch an African American's hair? Yes. So again, you have to think about some of those things. Another example of a microaggression is where, you know, you have a very vivid picture of someone. Maybe you're talking on the phone and you're getting ready to meet someone, and you're thinking that person is young, so you're making all these plans and you're making all these suggestions. And then when you finally meet the person, you realize that it's an older person, and your whole attitude, your whole behavior changes. So those microaggressions are, you know, very often they're not meant to be offensive, but they can be. And they're not meant to be hurtful and harmful, but they are. So we have to, again, get in contact with what are some of those different ways in which we can hurt people without realizing it.
And I guess it's, you know, if you can find the links to that, or if we can plant the seed in the audience who is out there, HR people, we design these programs so that they help the citizens, the employees out there in the workforce, supervisors, managers, business owners. There are so many small business owners out there that if you're under 100 employees, chances are you don't have a full-time HR professional mm-hmm. to kind of be what Juliee was describing as the coach, catch them doing something right, or because everybody's too busy. Mm-hmm. So I think in a larger employee size company, you might have more resources to address all this with. And I know Juliee and Michael have both had experiences, and they're very seasoned professionals. But I'd like to toss it back to them again in the last minutes that we have here to identify some of those successes and not so successful situations. You know, obviously we need a larger talent pool. We need to attract top talent. We need to drive innovation, and it can't just be HR that does this. So, Juliee, this is your probably your last shot at the panel remotely. What can you share with us?
Well, again, it comes down to communication and awareness and education. We cannot be afraid or be uncomfortable to pull people aside and have discussions with them and conversations and coaching and say that was not appropriate or that was appropriate. Because I think the worst thing we can do as HR people or employers, those small businesses that don't have an HR person, is to be silent when something wrong is happening, because silence implies consent. And when people get a feeling that you are consenting to bad behavior and you're not going to do anything about it as an employer, that's when it can get really hairy and very legal. Then you're in all kinds of legal trouble.
But if some of these if some of these things happen, because as Denise said, it was unintentional, but it was right. An unconscious bias. It might have been microaggression, mm-hmm. as we could label the behavior. Mm-hmm. But if it's without malice, then your approach is more the coaching and, hey, by the way, look at this kind of situation, as opposed to hitting them with a ton of bricks.
You know, Bob, one of the things that I always say, Juliee, is that mm-hmm. we have to, you know, we're aware of our intent, but we have to also be aware of the impact.
Exactly.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. For instance, another expression or example of microaggression is this is recently in the news when someone said to a person, "Wow, you're so articulate." Mm-hmm. Well, what does that mean? Does that mean I don't think you're as educated as I am? Does that mean you're a different race and I feel you're not as intelligent as I am? I mean, it can mean so many different things. And why would that even come out of your mouth? I mean, I think we have to teach people also to think before they speak. And that doesn't always happen.
Okay. Thank you very much. And Michael, I know you're standing there in the wings, getting ready to contribute again. So have at it.
So one of the things that I've been thinking about throughout this this broadcast, Bob, is, and I know Denise has brought it up before, and I don't think she touched upon it this evening, but I was thinking a lot about the golden rule. That was something that my grandmother really instilled in myself and my sister and my cousins during our childhood and growing up. But one of the things that was introduced more recently by Denise at a past training was the platinum rule. So the golden rule is certainly treating others the way you wish to be treated. And then, of course, the platinum rule is treating others the way they wish to be treated. And that kind of runs the gamut of DE&I, whether it's an interaction or whether it's identifying someone by the proper pronoun if they're part of the LGBTQ+ community. But I think, you know, nothing is ever foolproof, but I think if organizational leaders approach situations with that in mindset, what is the best way to treat this person or that I'm dealing with, or what is the best way to handle this situation, and thinking, always having in the back of your mind, either the golden rule or the platinum rule, or honestly both, I think really is a measure for success, or at least that's what I've found from a personal standpoint, working in different stores for the one particular company I was with for 14 years, or different industries. I think that is sound and stage advice.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much for that, Michael. And in the 6 or 7 minutes we have left, feel free to chime in anytime you can here. As we're getting down to the end here, I wanted to ask Denise again to, when did you have any aha moments about, and it's an excellent point, the golden rule versus the platinum rule. Can you share any aha moments where the clouds parted, the sun shone, the angels sang, and you got it in terms of the communication skills or the language for it? Or how do you implement the platinum rule? And if you've been successful at it, mm-hmm. how did you do it?
I think what really is important, it gets back to the basics. You have to have conversations with individuals. You have mm-hmm. to sit down, you have to ask questions, and you have to let them know that you care, that you truly are willing to, you know, to learn. Most importantly, we have to listen. You know, right now, today, we don't listen. We just automatically mm-hmm. assume we have the answers. So, you know, we ask a question of someone, and before you know it, we're off to the next question without waiting for their response.
Or we're talking over them mm-hmm. or whatever. Yeah.
It's... Right. So it's really important to start the conversations and really make sure that you have an open mind and that you're listening. And by the way, Bob, I do have that website where individuals can
Excellent.
Go.
Can you share it with us?
I sure can. So it's implicit, I-M-P-L-I-C-I-T dot Harvard, H-A-R-V-A-R-D dot E-D-U slash implicit, I-M-P-L-I-C-I-T slash take a test dot H-T-M-L.
And take a test is all one word?
All one word, yes.
So implicit dot Harvard dot E-D-U front slash implicit front slash take a test.
Mm-hmm.
Excellent. Well,
take a test dot H-T-M-L.
Dot H-T-M-L. Okay. Hypertext but machine language.
Yeah, and that's an excellent site. You can go out there because, you know, let's just say, oh, I don't have any bias around people that are overweight. You know, you can take it on weight. You can take it on age. You can take it on race, skin color. I mean, it's all these different biases that, you know, that we may feel we have or don't have, and it's there for you to take.
Well, I can say we've certainly shared a lot today on this, and I was just amazed at how much valuable information that State Council Legislative and Legal Update provided last Friday to us. It's an all-day thing. In the moments we do have left, I know I came across a couple of there's a book out there called Blind Spot, and I'd encourage everybody to pick up a copy of that, and especially in HR if you haven't already. There are state human resource commission .org sites that you can access that have initiatives on this. Another resource, gender inclusion terminology around the world. There are certain societies out there that are still heavily imbued with, shall we say, an unenlightened view of the world. And I can't imagine in that kind of environment. I mean, we might have our problems, but wow. I think just even with the LGBTQ plus narrative and the gender relevant conversations and the dialogue there, and the vocabulary is so specific. that it's hard to maybe get our hands around that. There's certainly lots to think about, lots to learn, and just to show you that HR does have a business side to them, because again, a lot of this is just good HR. A few statistics here. Companies with diverse management teams have 19% higher revenues.
Mm-hmm.
1.7 times. That's diverse companies are more likely to be innovation leaders in their market segment, almost double. Mm-hmm. 67% of job seekers say that diversity is an important factor when considering a company. And that came to what that plays to what Julie and Michael were saying about in their recruiting. Your advertisements have to be reflective of your workforce. And if that's not diverse enough, the labor force is not going to play suit to you. And 85% of chief executive officers say that having a diverse workforce improved their bottom lines. So the takeaway isn't, okay, we're going to make more money if we're more diverse. That's not what we're trying to say. And Denise is over here, probably shocked at try even implying that that's a connection, because it's not. And I will give her the due consideration and the expertise that she is. We covered most of everything here. Audience takeaways. Denise, I'll let it up to you to have that last view. I just need a moment to thank Chet and the panelists and be done. So,
mm-hmm. I would just say, when we talk about bias, I would ask people to take a moment and examine their expectations. Are their expectations the same for all individuals? You know, what's the expectation? Do they describe individual one way and describe another individual a different way? You know, do we always include race or skin color or something like that when we're describing someone? So again, take a look at your bias and see what's happening. When you enter a room, who do you go near? Who do you sit next to? Or who don't you sit next to? So these are just all ways in which you can begin to examine your bias.
Okay, well, thank you very much. I want to thank Denise Lee here, Director of Training and Development, for her sage conversation again and participation. Welcome back, and we'll have you back again, certainly. Julie Franey and Michael Holcomb, HR consultant and HR coordinators there, professionals, certified HR professionals in our chapter and in the Society for Human Resource Management, and also on the D&I committee for our chapter. Thank you both for your remote contributions. We'll certainly thank our underwriter, Mosteller and Associates. They're a full-service human resource professional services firm. Their phone number and fax number there, if people still use faxes. You can email Stacy there at his company. They're 2433 Morgantown Road is their international headquarters. We also want to thank the chapter under whose auspices we bring you this program. And if you like what you hear, if you're intrigued by any of it, if you want to learn more about HR, you do not have to have HR manager in your title to be a member. We have business owners, we have attorneys, and we have a number of people who service the HR profession. So we encourage you to reach out to our website, check us out, and see if any of it titillates your interest. With that, our next show is July 14th. We don't have a topic yet. We try to make topics as contemporary as possible. And not really upset anybody with how we view the world in HR. July 14th, 2020 is the next show. It'll be our 98th show and still be our 16th year. Thank you very much and good night.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Debbie Ramsey. I'm the Human Resource and Client Service Manager at Gage Personnel. I'm also the immediate past president of our local chapter. I'd like to tell you 10 top reasons why you should join our chapter. We have excellent speakers and an opportunity to bring a guest to any of our meetings. We also offer convenient breakfast and lunch sessions, volunteer opportunities, a certification study group, a Pal Olivet's Feed a Friend dinner, which is a great time and a great way to spend the holidays. We have a BCTV show, a monthly legal update with our local attorney, discount to our local chapter if you're a national member, recertification credits, and personal development. Our Berks chapter is a valuable resource for employers and employees alike. In my opinion, we help make Berks County a best place to work. Thank you.
Human Resource Management on BCTV is supported by Mosteller and Associates.